Hello and welcome back. I've actually made him continue to do this and we're here.
Today was like punishment. I'm like, I'm working out. She's like, we have to do this life so you can live, so you can live. I'm like, I'm alive now. I don't need to do this life. But here I am. I hope some people are joining in. Are we talking to like anybody out there?
Right now we're talking to five people.
Five. Okay, five is better than none.
There's a little number up there and you can tell how many.
You know, the other day people telling me, why were you looking so funny? It's because I'm squinting to look at the screen and read the names on the comments. So I look like weird. Like.
Well, so today we were doing the 6 o'clock live once again because he was busy during the day doing.
So we had our inspection by the Surgical Review Corporation to get our recertification as a center of excellence in bariatric surgery. And I spent in the morning talking to the inspector, and then right around lunchtime, we had to have the exit interview. He told us we passed, we're recertified, good for another 3 years, that our program results are amazing, our processes are amazing. She toured the hospital, the ER, the OR, the patients' rooms, everything, talked to all the staff and told us our program is very good to be recertified, and compared to other programs, we're doing great. So I spent most of the day doing that. No surgery today. So I had energy and I did a solid, strong workout. That's why I look kind of funny and disheveled and, you know, because I was working out till somebody said, we got to do live.
Yes, yes. So probably next week, we're going to be back to our regularly scheduled program at 12:30. So we'll be going on every Wednesday at 12:30, unless he has to work, and then we'll come on at 6.
Now, if you guys want us to change the time, you got to DM us a lot of, you know, comments. We want this other time and we'll do it. But we're going back to 12:30 on Wednesdays, which is usually I'm done with surgery. I can get to the office and we can do it comfortably.
Yeah, because we do it in the office. We have a little better lighting.
And we have somebody reads the question so I don't have to go.
Yeah, that helps. That helps a lot.
Yeah.
So we did have a few questions left over from last week. So one of the questions we received was, if you're paying for surgery, depending on the program that you choose, you have a certain number of visits included in that price for follow-up with Dr. Sosa. What happens after you have done all those visits, or you need to come see him 2 or 3 years from now? So anytime you have to come see him after your initial global period that you paid for with your surgery, the visits are $25.
You pretty much cannot see a doctor for $25, so it's pretty good. I mean, I've had patients tell me, I didn't have insurance, so I haven't come to see you. And I go, it's just $25. It's less than a copayment. Yeah. It's $25. And they go, really? I go, yeah, if you don't have insurance and you're going to pay for the visit, it's $25 to see me, to see the nurse practitioner, whatever. So if you need a question answered or whatever, and you don't have insurance, it's only $25. And if you come to the office and say, listen, I don't have the $25, but I really need to see Dr. Sosa, I'll see you. You can pay us later or whatever. But please don't not come to see me because you don't have insurance and you think it's really expensive or you don't have the $25, you know, that we charge for self-pay visits.
Yeah. I mean, we've tried to keep our prices the same throughout the 20-something years. I think the only thing that we've increased, and we only increased it by $5, was the multivitamins, and that's because the supplier increased it to us. So the product to make it got more expensive, so we had to increase it a little. But even that, you know, we always try to keep our prices low because we want the patients to be able to afford the things that they're gonna need after surgery.
Compared to gas, we haven't even increased with inflation. I mean, most things are up 10%, 20%. 50%, our price for surgery is not up. It's not higher than it was 3 years, 5 years, 10 years ago.
Okay, what about the nutritionist? The nutritionist price, I can't tell you right now because honestly, I don't know them off the top of my head, but I'll make sure that we go ahead and send you a message later with those prices, or you can call the office and they can give you the prices because they vary depending on what you're going in for. So there's 30-minute appointments, there's shorter appointments if you need to, and again, we can work with you
on
payment plans.
We don't have the exact number, honestly, but ballpark is not that expensive. It's 30, 40, 50 bucks, something like that. It's not like $200-$300 to see the nutritionist.
No, yeah, it's
very reasonable.
It is reasonable, and like I said, you can either do, you know, you can choose the time, and that'll also depend on how much it costs, because obviously they are going to spend time with you one-on-one, so we do have to book that time. Hold on, another question. That is super reasonable. Thank you.
We try.
We do try our best.
We try to keep things, especially things that you're gonna need, like follow-ups. We try to keep it reasonable so you stay engaged in the journey to your success.
Absolutely. We had two questions on hair loss. That seems to be one of the most popular topics that we get is about hair loss. So one of the questions was, is it normal that they're starting to experience hair loss after gastric bypass surgery? And they wanted to know, is it normal? Because they are worried.
Okay, it's common, but B, it's preventable. Again, so I did this before, but I'm gonna do it again. So what is hair? Hair is a derivative of protein. It's pure protein, so are nails. It's a derivative of protein. So when your body perceives, I do not have enough protein to maintain all the work that I need to do, the first thing your body does, it stops wasting protein. Nails and hair are kind of a waste of protein. So your body stops making new hair and your nails stop growing or grow much, much slower. Your hair falls out every day, it's normal, and it grows every day to replace it. If your hair continues to grow out and you stop replacing it, what happens? You look like you have hair loss. You get much thinner. What is the prevention? Protein supplements. Unfortunately, it's a significant amount of protein. You need to have about 70, 80 grams of protein to maintain hair. In the beginning, the first 2, 3, 4 weeks, you're not drinking the protein yet, so you're already in a little bit of a deficit. And then later, people will drink 20 grams, 30 grams. That's not really enough to prevent the thinning, the falling out that people call it. It's really thinning. So if you want to truly pretend, stop the thinning, you have to have 70, 80 grams a day, every day for 6 months. People look at it, their hair and go, oh, mine is not falling out. I'm doing great. I don't need that protein. It doesn't taste that good. 6 weeks later, boom. Oh my God, what happened? And now to catch up, it's gonna take 3 months. It's not like, okay, I'm gonna start taking the protein tomorrow and I'll start growing hair again. It's gonna take 3 to 6 months. The good news is when the hair loss is related to protein intake, it always grows back once you're eating enough protein. Once you're 6 months, 9 months, a year, you're eating steak, you're eating burgers, you're eating enough protein, your hair grows back. Now, if you're somebody like me, has genetic male ball pattern, don't think it's gonna grow back. You know, a lot of people go, oh, you know, 10 years ago I had hair and now I'm bald. I'm like, yeah, because you were gonna be bald because you have male pattern baldness. But if your hair is, you know, good and it starts to thin out, protein.
So he said a little tidbit that I want to just, from my personal experience, he said, eventually you'll eat enough protein. But honestly, even without the surgery, I don't eat enough protein. So I need to take a protein supplement. I'm taking a drink that has about 30 grams. So I'm adding 30 grams to what I'm getting from my food. And I'm trying to be very mindful about how many grams of protein I am getting from my food. You know, you can get there on your own. You just have to pay attention to what you're eating and maybe do a few swaps. There's a few things that you can swap out and replace them with healthier alternatives that are going to help with your protein intake. We're actually working, I'm working with our head nutritionist, Rosa. She's making a handout specifically about protein because this is one of our most common questions that we get. So I asked her to make a handout. She's already made it, so we got to print them and we're going to have them for you guys. We'll post it on our social media as well so that you can easily see, you know, 4 ounces of chicken has this much protein, 2 eggs has this much protein. So you can quickly glance at this handout and kind of like, okay, today if I did this, 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 and this, this is how much protein I would have.
What's the name of the drink? Do we remember? It's over there.
It's Fair Life.
Fair Life. I so just had one because after I work out, I have a protein because you want to be building muscle, so you need extra protein. So I just had one. So it tastes amazing.
So there's just as a warning, they have different sizes and different drinks. Please make sure to read the label.
Yes.
So what we have is the lowest calorie one. So we're always comparing how much protein to how many calories. So the one that we drink is 150 calories, and I think it only has like one sugar.
Right.
And then it has 30 grams of protein. So that one is very good.
When taking protein supplements, mm-hmm. be it liquid, be it a shake that you make, be it a bar, go high protein, mm-hmm. low sugar, low calorie. That's the best one. Sometimes people go, oh, this is amazing. It's got 300 calories and 10 of protein and 12 of sugar. That's not a protein bar. That's a snack bar. Okay. So high protein, low sugar and carbs, relatively low calorie. That's the best protein supplement.
Absolutely. So hopefully we'll have that ready for you soon, because I know it's our biggest question, and it's hard to figure out, like, you know, how much protein is in what. So just a little aside on something that I've been doing. It's something that I preach to the patients, so I am practicing what I preach. I am a firm believer in journaling, food journaling, either when you're not feeling well or when you're not losing weight or you've gained some weight. So I had, you know, gained a few pounds over the last few weeks. I probably gained 3 or 4 pounds, and I am building muscle, but I know that some of it was not muscle. So I started journaling again. So come, you know, Sunday, I got my book, breakfast, what I ate, how many calories, and how many grams of protein. Because my goal is to stay in a calorie deficit, which is go under the calories that I need for the day, and increase my protein intake. Very similar goal to what many of you should have. So I am counting my calories and I am counting my protein. I'm not counting anything else, but I always do try to stay low in my fat count. So, but I am specifically counting my calories and my carbohydrates. I'm writing it down, reading my labels. If you need help, the nutritionists also have appointments. If you want to make an appointment with them to do like a class to learn how to read labels, you can do that as well.
One of the questions was, do you have an app for your food journal?
I don't. We have some journals in the office that we sell, and I personally like to write it down. There is an app, it's called My Fitness Pal, and there's a bariatric one called Bariatric Pal. I gotta double check. But My Fitness Pal has been around for a really long time. That's an app that you download, and you can even search foods, and it'll tell you the calories and the requirements of each of those foods. And they even have a lot of restaurants listed on there. So I used to use My Fitness Pal. I personally do better with writing it down. Not only am I writing it down, I'm looking at it. It helps me remember. That's just my form of learning, is I like to write things down. So I'm using a pen and paper.
It's best to use what works for you, yes. and what you can keep.
Yes.
If you hate doing something, you're not getting in the habit. Or if it's something you like journaling. I personally have the best food journal. I have an AI that I tell I want to eat 600 calories with a lot of protein. And the AI tells me what I need to eat. So it's awesome. But if you don't have an AI, you know, there are apps and everything you can use. The goal, we'll talk another day more about what I call big D, little D. Big D is a diet. No, guys, it's not, you know. Big D is the diet. Little D is your diet. So one thing is a diet. You're going to go on a diet to accomplish something. If it's bodybuilding, you're going to go on a high protein diet, etc. If you need to lose weight, you're going to go on a restricted calorie diet. And we can talk about what are good diets, what are bad diets, what diets work for what, and what they don't. And then there's the small D, the diet that we eat every day, which is the diet that you should have high protein, low sugar, low carbs, good polyunsaturated fats. That should be part of your diet. Grains, nuts, healthy proteins,
whole foods,
that is the best, healthiest diet. Now, sometimes when you're on a big D diet, you don't worry about the healthy small D diet. You let go certain things like fruits, like certain high calorie vegetables, because you're on a diet to accomplish a goal, lose weight. And that might be a very restrictive diet, like paleo, like Atkins. So those diets, the point to use them is to accomplish a goal. Your regular diet, once you get there, or once, it has to be something that you can continue, that you can enjoy, but with the goals of low sugar, low calorie, high protein, and polyunsaturated fats. Good fats, not bad fats.
So what are polyunsaturated fats?
So it's a, I'm not gonna go into the chemical stuff, but polyunsaturated fats are fats that are much easier to digest and have no tendency to cause cardiovascular disease, plaquing, deposits in the arteries, etc. Unsaturated fats are the thicker fats, the animal fat, some of the lard that most restaurants that deep fry, the reason it tastes so good is they're deep frying in what we call lard, which is really a very saturated type of fat. So what you wanna do is stick to the polyunsaturated fats. They're healthier fats. Now, mind you, fat is essential to your health. You cannot live and survive without fats. We need them in the body. But the best fats to eat are the polyunsaturated fats. And you've heard about them all along. Fish fats, omega-3s, olive oil. Typical bad spectrum. Olive oil, good. Canola oil, bad. I mean, and so you gotta be a little bit educated on what's a good fat, and you gotta incorporate good fats into your diet. My personal bias is it is better to have more fat and less refined carbs in a healthy diet, little D diet, what you're gonna eat all your life, all along. It is much better to go with some stuff that is more fatty, especially if it's polyunsaturated, but minimize the sugar, the carbs, decrease, the sweet stuff, because that tends to lead much more to obesity, much more to depositing extra calories, adipose tissue fat that then kills you long term.
No bueno.
Azúcar, no bueno. Tastes really good. And people go all the time to me, but you have to have sugar to live. Actually, you don't. There is no sugar in nature. What is in nature is polysaccharides, are complex sugars. Monosaccharides, glucose, what we call sugar, table sugar, that white refined sugar, we invented. It doesn't exist in nature. In nature, whether it's a fruit or a sweetie vegetable, that sugar in there is a complex sugar. Your body has to break it down. The amount of calories it gets out of it is lower because of the complex digestive. We then invented refined sugar, monosaccharides, because it tastes good. It delivered a lot of calories at a time in history where calories were awesome because we, as hunter-gatherers, didn't get enough calories. But how do we invent sugar? The sugar cane, we invented how to take the cane, squeeze it, crystallize it, and get sugar out of it. That's a human invention. There's no sugar cane in history. You go to a sugar cane and it doesn't drop white sugar. It doesn't. Sugar is also made out of beets. Beets are kind of sweetie, but you don't squeeze a beet and get grains of sugar. We invented sugar. So sugar is not necessary for a healthy diet to live. Complex sugars, polysaccharides, yeah, but we're gonna find those in nature, in grains, in fruits, etc.
Thank you for that lesson. I'm not sure I followed it all.
Fats are better than sugar.
Sugar is bad. I got that part. Sugar is
protein and fat is better than sugar.
I mean, I think for everybody, I know you say it in the office all the time, you're always telling the patients, specifically the sleep patients, you know, if you're a sleep patient, you've heard him say this, no sugar, no sugar, no sugar, no sugar, sugar free.
Sugar is the enemy of most big diets, big D diets, and most little D diets, because if you put a lot of sugar in your daily diet, you're not going to be able to be, at a normal weight and a good metabolism. Sugar, is the enemy. We don't need sugar. We need polysaccharides, complex sugars, fruits, etc. Our body then makes the sugar glucose that our organs and our cells use. You don't need to eat glucose to live perfectly normal.
Thank you for that. Thank you for that lesson.
Polyunsaturated fats.
So now we know. Low calorie, high protein, low sugar. Right?
Right.
Got that.
Right.
And the good fats. The good fats.
And the good fats.
I'm not going to use the fancy word. I'm just going to say the good fats versus the bad fats.
We have a little time, so I'll do the big D, the diet. You're going to go on a diet. What's the best diet? What are you trying to accomplish? If what you're trying to accomplish is weight loss, decreasing the amount of fat, of adipose tissue in your body, the best diets are very high protein, pretty high fat, minimal or no carbs or low sugar. People call them by a bunch of names. The truth of the matter is, The one that really came up with this was Dr. Adkins. And for a long time, everybody criticized him because they told him, your diets are crazy. Yet what all the studies showed was his diet was not crazy. His diet was actually fairly healthy, because what he did is he got you to lose adipose tissue, got you to lose fat. So if you're trying to accomplish losing fat, losing weight, the best diet is Atkins, the new fancy term, paleo. Bottom line, high protein, pretty high fat, minimal carbs, minimal sugar. Why is that diet so good for losing weight? It provides satiety. When you eat a high protein, high fat meal with very low carbs, you stay unhungry. You have satiety for a long time. Volume wise, a big piece of food, be it a steak, a chicken, eggs and ham, that food is a big bolus of food that's gonna stay in there, take a long time to digest before you get hungry. So volume wise, you're gonna eat a lot more for much fewer calories versus a Cinnabon, which is small, is gonna give you twice as much calories as a protein meal. But the worst part is all that sugar is going to cause an insulin spike. The insulin is gonna spike, it's gonna drive out, down your blood sugar, and then you're gonna get really hungry again. So high carb diets, high sugar diets, A, you can eat less for the same calories, so it's hard to be calorie deficit. B, they don't provide satiety. It's a very hard diet not to be hungry through. People go, can a cookie diet work? Absolutely a cookie diet can work. But the amount of cookies that you can eat to match what's in a steak is 2 cookies. And then you're gonna be really hungry. Now, if you only eat the 2 cookies per meal, you're gonna lose weight. But no one does that. Everybody eats the 2 cookies and then another cookie. And so that's why those crazy carb diets don't really work, because they provide a lot of hunger. Whereas the high protein, high fat diets provide a lot of satiety. Now, is that a great diet for little D the rest of your life? You know, a steak, 2 eggs and cheese every meal? No, but those diets are to accomplish a goal, to get kind of close to your BMI, to your fat level that you need. Then you need to shift from that big D diet into the little D diet, where you begin to incorporate healthy things.
More of a balanced approach.
With a balance, now looking at not only the macronutrients, but the micronutrients. What's a healthier diet? More nuts, more vegetables, legumes, but still maintaining more protein, more polyunsaturated fats, minimizing carbs as you stabilize in a long-term diet. I always tell people, a diet that disgusts you, cauliflower rice, you're not gonna do. So don't waste your time doing a cauliflower rice diet.
Okay, so why does he say that? Okay. So, once upon a time, he's already mentioned his name a couple times. He's a huge fan of the Atkins diet. He's always been a huge fan of the Atkins diet. So, what did I want to do? I went and bought the book. I bought the book. I started reading. I started getting the recipes. And I was like, he came home and I was like, I cooked dinner and it's from the Atkins recipe book.
And she and made me cauliflower
mashed potatoes. It was cauliflower potato. Mashed potatoes.
The most disgusting thing you've ever tasted on earth. Probably as bad. What are those little things, that green stuff that you people try to make me eat?
Brussels sprouts.
Oh my God. Who eats that? I rather have a piece of steak or a fried egg with some cheese. That's at least palatable. It's the same thing. It's high protein. But Brussels sprouts and cauliflower, mashed potato, I'm not going to do that diet. So me being put into that diet will not work. So you gotta find what you can do, what you can handle to achieve the calorie deficit, high protein, high polyunsaturated fats.
We've become successful when we found the balance. First of all, one of the things that we do is many times we don't eat the same thing because we don't like the same thing. For lunch, we'll usually eat the same thing. But for dinner, many times we do not eat the same thing because we don't like the same thing. So that's one of the things that we've incorporated, is we each have what we like. And the second thing is to count our calories and our protein around the foods we like. Learn within the foods that we like what is viable for our goal. Right. So it's not like we're going to go, I did it once, it didn't work. We're not going to go buy, you know, a whole grocery full of vegetables because that's not our thing. We'll eat a few, not a lot. that's bad. We know. But this is what works for us. This is how we've made it work.
Fish is amazing. But if you hate fish, don't incorporate fish into your diet because you're not going to eat it. So you got to match kind of your taste to what's good, high protein, polyunsaturated fats, low carb.
Okay, so we had a question about credit for the bariatric surgery. Está en español. Sobre crédito, puede dejar su información en la página de esta, de Sosa Way. Manda un direct message, un DM. Dejas un nombre y número de teléfono y una de las coordinadoras la puede llamar y hacer la aplicación contigo por teléfono para ver si calificas para que te financien la cirugía.
Y explica que hacer la aplicación no afecta el crédito.
Sí. Nosotros trabajamos con dos compañías de financiamiento y ellos hacen lo que se llama un soft credit check, que quiere decir que corren un poquito, pero no afecta el crédito. So pueden chequear si ellos lo van a aprobar sin afectar su crédito. También aceptamos todo tipo de tarjetas de crédito. Y también muchas personas están cogiendo personal loans a través de sus bancos si tiene buena relación con su banco. A veces ese tiene un financiamiento más pequeño. So eso a veces ayuda. Y perdona mi español a veces. Sorry.
Estamos enseñándole a mi hijo español. Es bien difícil porque nosotros, más o menos, yo lo hablo un poco más.
Es mejor que yo, pero bueno, yo nací aquí. What can I say? So there was a question about, running their credit to pay for bariatric surgery. One of our coordinators, if you leave your information, they will reach out to you. They can do it. You can do the application with them over the phone, and it's a soft credit check, so it will not affect your credit. So. I guess back to the diet, right? What were we saying?
Well, we have 3 minutes, so we'll do the...
Okay, yeah.
What I do, what I want you to do, what I don't do. And today I'm going to put it into one. This is something that's amazing, it's really good, and I forget very, very often, and I don't do it enough. We're talking polyunsaturated fats. Yes. An amazing snack. You're hungry, it's the afternoon, dinner's not for 2 or 3 hours. Multigrain bread, which multigrain bread is very good because it has multiple complex grains. Then you take some olive oil, polyunsaturated fat, drizzle it. You get a slice of avocado, polyunsaturated fats, good healthy fats, you put it on the bread, and you sprinkle some garlic salt. Garlic is very good for you, and salt is not that bad in moderation. And that makes an amazing, tasty snack that is high on polyunsaturated fats, not too many calories, and very good for you, and it will fill you 3-4 hours till it's dinner time. So I love that snack. We often don't have what we need to make it, but when I remember and I have it, it's an amazing snack in the mid-afternoon, an avocado sandwich, multigrain bread, olive oil, garlic salt.
I think I'm gonna go buy that stuff. So that sounds
one of my favorite snacks that's actually good for you. Way better than reaching for a bag of chips or whatever that's pure carbs, pure sugar. So.
Definitely, I know it's one of the hardest things for me is to be mindful of my snack. I'm pretty good with breakfast, I'm pretty good with lunch, and I'm pretty good with dinner. It's easy to be mindful for me anyways. Snack is my downfall.
Oh. Right now, the one I'm doing that I absolutely adore is the ones that have the calorie counts, 100 calories of a pack of almonds or nuts with cranberries. A, you know it's 100 calories. Now, if 100 calories is not enough, you can do 2 packs and it's 200 calories. You're not breaking the bank with 200 calories. And it's high protein and it fills you. Almonds, nuts, an amazing snack. You can't have the whole bag, but if you have a limited amount of calories, it will fill you and it's a very healthy snack. Way better than most of the carb-based snacks like chips or, I won't say brand names, but all that crunchy stuff that is pure sugar.
So he just said something, so before we go real quick, he's talked about like getting something from a big bag. If you're going to be eating something that is in a big bag, you need to look at the serving size and you need to serve yourself either in a cup, a bowl, in a Ziploc bag, the serving size. Put away the big bag and have the serving size. We try to buy things that come in single servings just so that your mind doesn't play that trick on you, and so you know that what you need to eat is just that one little bag. But if you are having food out of that's more than one serving size, and it's very important to serve it and then put the big bag away.
Be very mindful of serving size. And a lot of times they're tricky. They'll go 200 calories per serving. Number of servings, 10. Which means
in a small bag.
In this bag. So which means you can have this much of it to be one serving, 200 calories. If you have all 10, 2,000 calories. You gotta be mindful of serving size.
All right, guys. Thank you for joining us. We'll be back next Wednesday at 12:30. And we hope to see you then. Have a great night.
Have a great night. Good night.